وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين that we, by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we get the chance to fast the month of Ramadan. And then, alhamdulillah, we celebrated the Eid of Eid al-Fitr. And all this, my dear brothers, truly great blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should be very thankful, praise Allah for all his gift. And we pray that Allah Azza wa Jal accept from all of us the fasting of Ramadan and give us all long life with good health to fast many Ramadans to come by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As you know, my dear brothers and sisters, we before Ramadan, we were able, alhamdulillah, and this is alhamdulillah, by the mercy of Allah, to cover the book of fasting before the start of Ramadan. And in the book of Bulugh al-Maram, as you know, this is the book of Bulugh al-Maram that we are explaining. In fact, what we do, we follow the order of the hadith, the order of the hadith of the book. So it's not based on subjects and points, but general subject, which is about Hajj, and then list of a hadith. And we take all these hadith one by one and explain it. And from these hadith, we can derive the many rules which is related to this ibadah. Before I will start, I just give, if you give me a few seconds to check something here. Barakallahu feekum. And your brother Ahmad and Majid, you can pose the Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So we'll go, inshallah, as I mentioned, we will start the book of Hajj, Kitabul Hajj, the book of Hajj. And alhamdulillah, it is also blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it comes, explanation of this book, it comes in the correct time, that's mean in the right time, because now we will start, inshallah, the Hajj season in 2 months from now. The Hajj will take place, and it will be, inshallah, we have at least 8 meetings by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, and we hope that we can explain all the narrations which is related to the book of Hajj. As we do always, we read the hadith and then we give the explanation. So if brother Abdul Majid will start, Jazakallah khair, read the first hadith.
Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the performance of Umrah is an expiation for all the sins committed between this Umrah and the previous one. And the reward for Hajj Mabrur, the one accepted by Allah, or the one which was performed without doing any wrong, is nothing but paradise, agreed upon.
Right. As you see, this is very strong hadith because it is agreed upon. That means it was mentioned in the two sahih. It was mentioned in the sahih of Imam al-Bukhari and al-Imam Muslim. So this hadith known as muttafaqun alayh, muttafaqun alayh, which means agree upon between the most authentic two reporters of the hadith, al-Imam al-Bukhari and al-Imam Muslim, rahmatullahi ala alayhim wa ala jami' ulama al-Muslimin wa mat al-Muslimin. طيب. In this hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, "Al-umratu ila al-umra kaffaratun lima baynahuma, wal-hajj al-mabrur laysa lahu jaza'un illa al-jannah." طيب. Now we start. What's the meaning of umrah and what's the meaning of hajj? Umrah means visit. This is the linguistic meaning. Al-umrah The meaning is the visit, to visit the place. Now, when it's come to as Islamic term, it is visiting the grand Masjid al-Haram, the grand mosque in Mecca, following as an act of worship for Allah Azza wa Jal, following certain rules, So this is what we call it Umrah. So which means this rules in, including is what? Al-Ihram, wal-Tawaf, wal-Sa'i, wal-Qas, al-Halq, wal-Qas. So this is the meaning of Umrah. Performing certain rules in a way to worship Allah by doing Ihram, Tawaf, Sa'i, and shape or cutting. So this is the meaning of the Umrah. Now when we come to Hajj, Al-Hajj means Al-Qasd. Al-Hajj means Al-Qasd. That's mean to intend to go to certain place. And here is, the place is Mecca, Al-Haram, Baytul Haram, and certain places which is out like Arafah and Mina. Right. Well, Hajj also, a certain ritual, inshallah, will explain it. Right. So Al-Hajj wa al-Dhihab ila Mecca, to doing certain rituals. And Al-Hajj, as every Muslim know, is one of the pillars of Islam. This is known for every Muslim, that Al-Hajj is one of the five pillars of Islam. You know the pillar of Islam. And this was mentioned in the hadith of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Prophet, which was narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, this hadith also agreed upon, which said, Bunya al-Islamu ala khams. Islam was built on five. Shahadatu an la ilaha illallah, the testimony of faith, wa anna Muhammad Rasulullah, wa iqam al-salah, performing and establishing prayers, the five prayers, wa ita'u al-zakah, and giving charity and zakah, وصوم رمضان and fasting the month of Ramadan وحج البيت وحج البيت in some narration for the one who is able. So Al-Hajj is the fifth pillar of Arkan Al-Islam, and as you know all the obligation of Islam did not come all together at once, but it was revealed to the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gradually. And the Hajj was almost the last one. This because Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala prescribed it in the ninth year after the Hijrah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's 1 year before the death of the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So in the ninth year. Therefore, the Prophet Alaihi Wasallam, he performed Hajj, which is the only Hajj, one that he did, in the 10th of, the 10th year after the Hijrah, and many people at that time, they performed Hajj with the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Hajj, my dear brothers, is one of the best of ibadat, of act of worship, because as we mentioned, first, it is the pillar, one of the pillars of Islam. And in Hajj include all other types of ibadat. Because if you look at the Salah, Salah is an act of ibadah, which is physical ibadah, physical act of worship that we do by your body and by your heart and by your mind. So this is related to the body, physically. If you look at Sawm, it is also related to the body. And if you look at the Zakah, it is the Ibadah, the financial type of Ibadah. It is financial. This is money, giving money, supporting. So, it, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He commanded us with all these rules, for what? to purify us. Yuzakkihim. This is one of the purpose or one of the goals of sending the messenger. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Jum'ah. الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته reciting his verses ويعلمهم الكتاب teaching the book which is the Quran والحكمة which is the Sunnah the wisdom ويزكيهم ويزكيهم purify them. So Islam is to purify us. So certain acts of ibadah to purify our body and soul like prayer and fasting. Other to purify our wealth. This is why it's called zakah. The money that we give, it's called zakah. Why? Because it is purification for our income, for our wealth. So now if you look at Hajj, it's included all types of ibadah. All types of ibadah is included in the trip of Hajj. This is why Al-Hajj, subhanAllah, it was required only once lifetime in the life of the believer, the Muslim. Not like other ibadat. Some of them daily, like prayers. Some of them weekly, like Salatul Jum'ah. Some of them once a month and 1 year, which is Sawm Ramadan. And the Hajj is once our lifetime. This is why it's like summarizing all types of ibadah. So in Hajj, prayers, and we pray regular prayer, and also shortening the prayer, like the traveler, when it's in the day of Arafah. So we included this both, the prayer in two ways, as complete or as shortening and combined. Is there fasting in Hajj? Yeah, there are. There are for some people who cannot afford the Hadi to fast 3 days in Hajj and 7 when they return to their homeland. So this is included there. It is spending money because it's expenses and struggling like jihad, striving. So Al-Hajj, in fact, included all forms and types of ibadat. And this is why the one who performs Hajj, it's like the one who strive and go for fighting for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this will one of the hadith that will come after this hadith. Because when Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is there jihad for women? We know that jihad has been fighting for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect the Muslim land, protect Muslim community, Muslim state, is must on only on men. It's not must obligatory in women. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when Aisha asked him, is there jihad for women? He didn't say no, he said yes. And then he explained, there is jihad where there's no fighting. Jihadun la qitala fi, which is al-hajj wal-umrah. Al-hajj wal-umrah. Right. So what we learn from this hadith, which is the reported or narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, when he said al-umratu kaffarat lima baynahum, from one umrah to the next one there's expiation, that means it will remove sins. And you remember many times we mentioned this, the argument among ulama, is this include all types of sin or levels of sin, or it is only for the minor sin. The sound view, that this referring to the minor sins that the Muslim may commit during his life. So this is why from one umrah to the next one, all the sins by the will of Allah Azza wa Jalla will be removed from your account. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may turn it to good deeds by the blessing and the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then al-hajj al-mabrur, what does it mean, mabrur? Purified hajj that done sincerely for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, not to show off. But the intention is very important in all types of ibadah. And here it is also important. That intention, that what ibadah, what act of worship we do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when the Muslim perform hajj in the correct way, with sincerity, following the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in other hadith, lam yarfuth wa lam yafsuq. And he didn't do anything, any filth, any types of talk that may nullify his good deeds or his hajj, then what's the reward? It's not only expiation, but al-jannah. There is no reward except jannah. That's mean he guarantees jannah just by doing this act of ibadah. And this is why here, my dear brothers and sisters, we should understand this following point. First of all, that al-ikhlas lillahi azza wa jalla. Ikhlas, what does it mean? That means sincerity. So when the Muslim, he go or he intend to perform hajj, he should do it for the sake of Allah, for the sake of success and get reward of the hereafter. Not to get praise from people. Unfortunately, now some people that they do, when they go to Hajj, instead of keeping themselves busy with, you know, du'a, with remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they kept equipped themselves with taking pictures, you know, through live streaming and mobile to show people that I am here, I am in Mecca, I am in Arafah, I am in Mina. We are not talking about his intention. Only Allah Azza wa Jal subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's in his heart. But all these acts, it's not, in fact, it doesn't help the Muslim to concentrate and purify his intention, his niyyah. You know that the ulama and the righteous people of the past, what they do? They don't show off of any acts of ibadah. They are afraid that even they are sincere, even though they are afraid that you know, they are committing some show off, and may Allah Azza wa Jalla may not accept it from them. This is what this was what said, mentioned that some of the ulama, when he give us, for example, he give in front of his students and his teaching, and then he felt the khushu' or the effect of the subject that he talk about, and then tears will come from his eyes, or maybe he will feel that he will is weeping. He try not to show this to the people around them. So sometimes, if his voice was changed because he almost weeping or crying, you know, of what he is saying or what he is reading, so he will maybe come, he will say, this is, I got flu, or is it flu, or he try to turn the attention of the people of what they are seeing from him. All this for what? To make sure that what he is doing is hidden from the eyes of the people, to keep it with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, it is very important. Sincerity is very important. So the Muslim, when he go there, he should not show off. Some people, some haji, they go to hajj, and all in their mind is when they return back home, they will be called Haji so and so. He will get the title of Haji. This is his intention. And when he gets it, this is what he got. Why? Because this is what, as the Prophet said, كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله. The one who his immigration is for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal and his messenger, it will be written like that. ومن كانت هجرته لامرأة يصيب لدنيا يصيبها وامرأة كعبة فهجرته إلى ما هجر. The one who just make migration just for this worldly gain, he will get what he intended. And the same thing, this is why it's very important to make sure that when we go to Hajj, when we do any ibadah, we take all the measures to stay away from showing off and keep it sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like some people, they perform Hajj for money. Is there some people do this? Yes, there are. How? There are some people, they are taking, performing Hajj in behalf of people, other people who are not able, for the purpose of what? Of business and getting money. So they perform Hajj in behalf of so and so. But what they get? Will they get reward for their Hajj? They will not. Why? Because their intention, their purpose is to get this money, to gain this money. And thereafter, we get nothing from this. But that doesn't mean, you know, if somebody, he sincerely, he performed Hajj in the name of somebody else, in behalf of somebody else, and he gets some money for the expenses of this trip, no problem with this. The important thing is not the money that he takes this to support his trip, but the important thing is what is in his heart. Is the main goal for him is to gain the money? Or he said, well, I wish that I can perform Hajj. At the same time, I serve my brother who is in need for somebody else to perform Hajj on his behalf. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who know about all these intentions. So the first thing is what? Sincerity. The second thing in Hajj is what? To follow exactly the way of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the last year before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was able to perform Hajj with many people with him who saw him, to show us not only in words but in action what is the right, the correct way to perform Hajj. And during his Hajj, the Prophet ﷺ used to repeat, "Khudu anni manasikakum." Khudu, take from me, look at me. Anni manasikakum. Look at me. Learn from me what you should do in your Hajj. Learn how to perform your Hajj by following my example. Therefore, my dear brother, any act of ibadah will not be accepted if was not for the sake of Allah, this one condition, and it was not on the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These two conditions, preconditions for every ibadah, every act of worship, that you do it to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter if the ibadah is very major one, like Hajj, or even nice word that you say, or one riyal, or rubiyah, or whatever money, little money that you give for the people. As long as the intention is not for the sake of Allah, the person will not get the reward for it. As long as the ibadah, no matter how perfect is it, how, I mean, beautiful is it, how much money that he spent, if it was not following the example of the Prophet ﷺ, then it will not be accepted, it will be rejected, especially if there is bid'ah, if there is innovation. And this is why, my dear brothers, some people, they go to Hajj without knowledge. This is my advice. And it's not, in fact, my advice, but it is the obligation of every Muslim that before he perform any act of ibadah, he should learn how to do it. I mentioned before, مَا لَا يَتِمُّ الْوَاجِبِ إِلَّا بِهِ فَهُ وَاجِبِ. This is one of the golden rule in Islam as related to our act of worship. Anytime, anything that the obligation cannot be done without it, it's become obligation. So you cannot perform Hajj without learning, without knowing how to perform it in the correct way. Therefore, learning how to perform Hajj is very, very important. Many people, they go to Hajj without, they said Hajj, and they registered. And they go, it's like a trip, like a picnic, they take it, like a journey, like tourists. And that's not right. And they just put the ihram and they go with people. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. They don't know, you know, many things about the basic, about the rules. Therefore, they made many faults in Hajj. And after Hajj, they come and ask ulama, Ya Shaykh, I did this in Hajj. I wasn't aware that it is not lawful. I didn't do this, which is must. I didn't know that it is must. It's not a good excuse. Before we go to Hajj, first of all, we should learn and study. And this is also the responsibility of Islamic centers, of schools, of any group who are taking care of the Hajjaj to make or prepare special course, like preparation for Hajj. Many people, they prepare money, they prepare clothes, they prepare many things, their ticket, their visa, everything. And they forget about the most important thing, which is what? The knowledge. How to learn, how did the Prophet ﷺ perform his Hajj? Right. So if people, they perform Hajj based on the way of the Prophet ﷺ, this is the other condition. There is one also condition relate to Hajj, that the money that the person use in Hajj should be from what? From lawful sources, lawful income. But the person is dealing with riba, selling something which is haram, doing unlawful business and collecting money and then come to Hajj. This is not correct. This is not right. Because it's Hajj, it will not be considered as purified Hajj. And the Hajj itself is not correct. And if the person did it this way, still he have to perform Hajj when he get lawful sources. So the Muslim should be aware. Why? Because inna Allah tayyib la yaqbal illa tayyib. Allah Azza wa Jalla is good, he will not accept except that which is good. So the person who have money from cheating, from stealing, from dealing in riba or anything which is lawful, and then he go to Hajj, it's better for him not to go to Hajj. Why? Because this will not be accepted. First of all, purify your sources of income and then go to Hajj. It is also very important for the Muslim to avoid anything. We know that the Muslim should avoid forbidden things and lawful matters. There is no question about this. But since you are going to Hajj, you should be more cautious and more careful to avoid even something which there is doubt about it. This is why it's very important to care about what we say, what we talk, what we do, especially in this trip. Try our best to make it as good as it is possible. Like, you know, some people, they go to Hajj. MashaAllah. He is sincerely, he did it for the sake of Allah with good intention. He knows some of the ritual, the way he have good income. But when he go to Hajj, he commit many sins. Maybe hurting people, insulting people, shouting, push them, bother them with different ways and say bad words. All this something that which is not lawful, and the Muslim should stay away of. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجِ الْحَجِ أَشْرٌ مَعْلُومَاتٍ. Hajj is certain month, known month. فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجِ. So the one who want to perform Hajj, فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِ. No rafat, no filth, nothing which is bad in action, bad in words. Wala jidal, even argument. Yeah. Many people, they get involved in argument, shouting against each other, and you can see them. Where is their patience? They should be patient. This is the purpose of Hajj, to teach us how to be patient, how to be accommodate with our other brothers. It's not in your... You are not in your home here. You are mixed with people from different backgrounds, different cultures, different languages. Maybe they act in a way, for them, this is acceptable. In your culture, this is something, it's not right. And you go and shout on them. We should accommodate them, and we should be very patient. That is to make our Hajj by the will of Allah Ta'ala is... accepted. So this is, as we said, Hajj, expiation, as conclusion for this hadith, has is expiation for sins. And the best or the purify Hajj, it will remove all previous sin. In other hadith, it will come, kharaja min dhunubi kayawmi waladatum. The one who performed with Hajj, he come out or return home as he was just born with no sin. But my dear brothers, it's very important to know that Hajj is must on the Muslim when he is able to do it. You know, many unfortunately young men and young women among Muslim who are healthy and wealthy and able to perform Hajj, but they postpone Hajj. They said, not yet. Some of them, they have the bad, the wrong concept about Hajj. They said, we'll stay till the end of my life, and then I perform Hajj so I can clear all my sins. So he collect all the sins, and he have the feeling that he will live long life. So when he get old, he will perform Hajj. This is wrong. This is from the trick of the shaitan. The Muslim, as long as he is able to perform Hajj, he should not delay it. This is why some ulama said the Hajj is must al fawr. That's mean as soon as the person is able to do it, then he should not delay it. We'll say just a few words about the second hadith, and then we'll stop and take your question. Will you go to the next hadith, brother? Can you see it? Yeah.
No, Sheikh. If you can scroll it up.
Ma'am?
I cannot see, Sheikh.
Okay, let me see it. Hi. Ma'am, can you see it now?
You need to scroll it up, Sheikh.
Right.
Yes. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha narrated, I once asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, is jihad incumbent upon women? He replied, yes, they have to take part in jihad in which no fighting takes place, which is Hajj and Umrah. related by Ahmad and Ibn Majah, and the wording is his. It is reported with a sound chain of narrators.
Right. This is what we mentioned, I just mentioned before, when we said about, when we talk about it as introduction. So in this hadith, as you see, it is, there is indication that the woman, the Muslim woman, is not required to participate in fighting, unless there's one situation only. If the enemy enter the Muslim town, so everyone should take his part in defending the Muslim, and then the Muslim woman maybe can participate. But as fighting, it's not required from a Muslim, only in situation of defending. And we are not going, inshallah, next week, inshallah, we'll start with conditions of Hajj, because here we talk about one condition, which is about a woman, and the woman also need mashram when she intend to perform Hajj. I think this we can stop here, brothers and sisters, Jazakumullah khair, and we'll leave some time for your question, and next time, inshallah, next week, we'll continue with our hadith. Barakallahu feekum. So if you have any question, you can ask related to this or any other subject. Barakallahu feekum. Nah. Anyone who wants to ask, he can raise hand, and then Brother Abdul Majid will give him a chance to ask. Yes. A question for Marcus? Yes. Unmute your mic, brother, and you can ask.
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Yahya.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome, brother.
Yeah, doctor, I would like to ask regarding this Hajj, performing the privilege of Hajj, because I'm a new Muslim, I think that 3 years ago, so I never performed the Hajj yet. So now I continue study to the Dawah Center for level one, level two. So I would like to ask about this because, you know, I just only a driver, so meaning that I cannot be afford to perform the Hajj, so I depending on only to the Dawah Center to perform or to encourage us to being a student to perform the Hajj of that program example. So we can...
Now, brother, you see, in a term of obligation, Hajj is not must on you. Why? As you mentioned that you are not able to perform Hajj, because one of the conditions of performing Hajj is ability, financially and physically. And you cannot meet the financial side, as you mentioned. As a student of an Islamic center, this is something different, and you can check with the Islamic center that you study. We know that, alhamdulillah, there are some Islamic centers here in the kingdom and even outside the kingdom who are taking care of their students and helping them. They get support, some donation from some generous people to help those who are in need to perform Hajj. So the only way is to check with the Islamic center that you, the administration there, and maybe they have a plan for Hajj. We know that in the past, many of the Islamic centers, including our Jeddah Dawah Center, they have program for Hajj. But in the last 3 years, because of, as you know, the COVID-19, this program was stopped. We hope that this year there will be a program the delegation to go for Hajj, and inshallah you can register. So just keep in touch and ask your teacher, ask your the administration of your the Islamic center, and inshallah if there's a program, maybe they can inshallah take you for Hajj.
Barakallah. Inshallah. Thank you very much. Inshallah.
Inshallah. Is there a question?
I have one, Shaykh. With regard to you explain the Badal Hajj. So when someone accepting the responsibility to perform a Badal Hajj, and he also being paid the expenses involved, if his niyyah, the ikhlas is, for the sake of Allah to perform this Hajj and make the reward for the person intended, will he be also getting a copy of the reward for taking part in this?
No, he will for sure, by the will of Allah Azza wa Jalla, because the, as we said, everything depends on the intention. So as long as his intention is not just making Hajj Badal, Hajj for somebody else, on behalf of somebody else, just to
no sound.
You're muted, Sheikh. Can you unmute, please?
Okay, sir. So how much you hear from what I said? Anyway, in conclusion, I said, if the person is sincerely for the sake of Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very generous and will, inshallah, reward for this. But not as some people who take it as business, just to collect money from people. Nah. طيب. If there's no question, then we'll conclude our class. And we'll shall I see you next week. For brothers and sisters who are following us, or they view in the Facebook, they can post their questions in the window, I mean comment window. And for those brothers and sisters in the group, WhatsApp group also, they can send their question to the group, and the admin of the group, inshallah, they will forward it to me, or they can say it next week, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Barakallah feekum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in the knowledge of the deen, and we benefit from whatever we say and whatever we hear and whatever we learn, and make this knowledge testify for us, not against us in the day of judgment. Barakallah feekum wa jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakumullah khair.
Jazakumullah.